We have the program today organized by the NIAS Consciousness Studies program, and particularly the forum called Svasthya Rasa Bodhini, which intends to bring the correlations between different kinds of human experiences that focuses on knowledge, what we call as health or well-being, and how both are also connected with identity and self. So it's basically bringing in at least three different dominant human experiences together and to see the emergence of new understanding through that. So it's also a kind of avoiding the break of disciplines and avoiding the break of human experiences or dissection of human experiences. Most of the time, certain experiences are so complex that we have to understand it from a conjoined perspective as well. So on behalf of the director, Dr. Shailesh Nayak, on behalf of director of this institute, Dr. Shailesh Nayak, behalf of the program, and behalf of the series called Svasthya Rasa Bodhini, and on behalf of all my colleagues and scholars of the program, it's great pleasure for me to introduce a very distinguished scholar, historian, and writer. You might have already known he's very well featured. His features are very well read, and also his writings are of a very high degree of scholarship. So it's extremely a great privilege to have Dr. Shashank Sinha here with us. Dr. Sinha is an independent scholar, and his current research interests include tribes, gender, violence, and culture and heritage. He has taught history in undergrad colleges at the University of Delhi, and has authored Restless Mothers and Turbulent Daughters, Situating Tribes in Gender Studies. Dr. Shashank Sinha has published extensively on the history of witchcraft and witch hunting. He writes regularly on heritage, including a series on the World Heritage Sites, and is currently finishing a book, Imperial Cities of Delhi and Agra, Monument Cities and Connected Histories. He has earlier worked as a senior commissioning manager with Oxford University Press, and he is currently the publishing director for Routledge of South Asia. So I'm extremely grateful to Dr. Sinha for taking the time out of his busy schedule and be here for 3 to 4 days, because we are also having the review meetings of some of our projects of the program. So we are so thankful that he could find this much time spent with us and give a lecture on this topic, which is so fascinating. And it's such a multifaceted topic that we are so eager to listen to him. So after the lecture, we would have a discussion. And so it goes like that. So may I invite Dr. Shashank Sinha for this evening's lecture.
Thank you, and good evening, all of you. I must first thank NIAS, Professor Menon, and all of you for giving me a chance to share some of my findings. I've been working on this area. I've shifted, I've got into new set of work now on heritage sites, but this is something which has always kept coming back to me. And it's always nice to talk about it. But, normally when we talk about ghosts and spirits, they are fearful, but also an enjoyable experiences as well. You talk about stories related to them. But today, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to disturb you. I'm going to force you to think, or at least I'm trying to do that, to force you to think about an area which has not been adequately studied, and an area which has always been summarily dismissed as a superstition. Right? So I'm going to do that. And to begin with that, this is something that when you see on this slide, it was installed very recently, last couple of months in Orissa. So it's a memorial, witch hunt victims memorial. It's just been installed in Keonjhar district in Orissa, just recently, very recently. And I'm going to use a second slide, and after that, nothing else, which will be a template which I'll not use, but this is just for you to read, while I'll be talking about you about many, many things as well. But just to give you that, they're locally known as Dayan or Tony or Bisahis. The National Crime Records Bureau, which has just recently started compiling the figures, has said that has reported cases from 17 states. And 10 to 12 states regularly report cases related to witch hunting. And you know, in the last, you know, 2001 to 2016, there have been more than 2,500 women been killed as witches, you know. But that is not, does not come up, you know, summarize the nature of experience. For what I'm going to talk about is not just the killing. Killing is just one aspect of hunting. I'm going to talk about witch hunting, which you see in blue, you know, which manifests itself in so many different ways. Violence, public humiliation, lots of things that I'll be talking about. And I say that it is not just about, you know, superstition or education or lack of education or healthcare. It's about so many different things. I've found it to be a very layered phenomenon over this period of time. And you know, in 2014, there's a national javelin, you know, champion who's won several gold medals, was, you know, accused of witchcraft in Assam and was badly harassed by the villagers, you know. So this is a phenomenon which, you know, affects a lot and goes much beyond what we think is obvious. The reason I thought I'll use Central India was that, you know, while I'm primarily would be talking about or using Jharkhand or Bihar as an example to talk about Central Asia, Central India, was that many of these states, you know, and I can certainly say that about, you know, Orissa, Bengal, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, Rajasthan, they share elements of their historical past, at least as far as this area is concerned. But obviously no long-term study exists of any state anywhere, you know. We get parts of it, you know, basically, which I could see in my research. But, you know, and but the Jharkhand has also got this unique distinction, or dubious distinction, of being, you know, area where you have largest number of cases being, you know, of women being killed as witches, you know. But what you also see is in the last couple of decades, all that I talk in the name of witch hunting is true about entire Central Indian belt. It's all those 10 to 12 states that I'm talking about. The ways in which this thing has surfaced is very, very true of all those things. Let me begin with two things, you know, two of my principal arguments. One is that, you know, I argue that, you know, the world of spirits or witches was never a dead or a dead ancestors. It was never a dead insular world. It continuously intersected and resonated with changes in socio-political milieu to acquire new forms and meanings. So they were continuously, it was not a dead world, insular world. It was continuously changing. And the other thing is that, you know, this was internally and externally how the ethno-regional ideas of witchcraft or spirit world intersected with those new agents and forces, whether it's anthropologists or the colonial state or Christian missionaries or ethnographers, to acquire very complex web of meanings, you know. And when I say that, I, you know, and the way I present it, you know, let me make two clarifications. One is that, you know, I talk about constructions. How does the idea of witch manifest, you know? So I'm, to me, that is more substantive, or for the purposes of current lecture, more consequential than objectivity of the practice itself. Do you believe in witchcraft? That's not my concern. I believe in the constructions of witchcraft, you know, and how does affect the image of the witch. And the second one, in this, for the purposes of this lecture, I'm taking a very linear, simplistic view, but that's to make the narrative more simple. But, you know, obviously there are lots of intersections, there are lots of overlaps, and there's a lot of randomness as well, right? Let me take you to some of those, you know, let me begin with some myths, you know, obviously, just very briefly. So there were three myths regarding the origin of witchcraft, you know, or, you know, related ideas to witchcraft. So, you know, and I'm talking about the different tribes now that they are, you know, residing in the region. So one is a Santhal, you know, myth about the origin of the witchcraft, which by says that, you know, there's women who duped the men. And when men were going to, you know, deity, it's called the mountain deity, Maranburu, to, you know, they said that teach us something by which we can control the women. And women somehow got to hear about it. So next day, and so they went to Maranburu and they said, "Ki, we are ready to do anything." So he said, he took out some sal leaves and said, "Okay, you know, from your hand, take out some blood and make your impressions on these sal leaves." At which point they got very afraid. They said, "We'll come back tomorrow." But women had been following them, So the next day they got them drunk, and you know, the myth says they got them drunk, you know, wore their clothes and went to Maranburu, the mountain spirit, and said, "We have come, teach us the witchcraft." And he taught us the witchcraft. And next day when men went there, and they says, "But I have already taught you witchcraft." Right? So he made them experts in witch hunting or witch finding. So witch versus the witch doctor, you know, how it gets into the gendered domain. There are two others, which is about Asur Kahani, which is about very common among the Mundas and Oraos, which ascribes this Asurs with the iron smelters, the traditional iron smelters. So it is ascribes them to, you know, widows of them. They were causing problems in the heaven, you know. So the chief deity, you know, gets them, you know, burnt in the in the furnaces. And when the widows approached them, said, "Ki, what we'll do now?" So he says, "Okay, now you would survive on what people would offer you." So he made them spirits and witches in different parts of inhabiting them. And there is a third one called Anom, which is again very common among the Mundas, which is of legend of Baranda Bonga, which is, you know, whereby even the chief deity's second wife is a witch and he finds it very difficult to control it. Right? Now, from there, I move on to where I want to start. And I'm taking you way back in, say, around 1840s and 1850s. What did a witch mean then? Who was a witch? And there are two or three characteristics that emerges here, you know, around this idea of the witch. A, that they were hereditary. It was a hereditary trait. So if you were a witch, you know, the thing would run into the family. And that they would harm in primarily two ways: evil eye, where they see you, or evil mouth, where they talk about you. And in which case things start deteriorating, and then either you die or you suffer, or, you know, those kinds of things. So the way of dealing with this kind of a witch was essential physical elimination. They had to be killed. So while there was a remedy for, you know, angry spirits and angry, you know, ancestors, you know, who had died, you know, witches had to be physically removed. They had to be killed. There are several examples of that. I'll talk to you about just one part of it. There is an assistant commissioner called Lamaicus, you know, who is reporting an incident, and which is incident is about, you know, a woman who has just been killed. And the young child is crying next to the mother. And the father is in a very desperate situation. So because the child is hungry and is crying, you know, wailing, you know. So he offers rupees 10, which was then a very big amount. I'm talking about 1850s, you know. But nobody, no woman came forward, because they didn't want their breast to be polluted by the offspring of a witch, you know, basically. Right? Now, so widespread was this idea that in 1840s and 50s, when the British were there, you know, they tried to outlaw this practice. So they said that no amount of savagery or barbaric custom would be tolerated, and anybody who tries to kill a witch or is into those kind of practices would be punished by capital, by death. And this is one which they had did not only have in, you know, Chotanagpur, which was Jharkhand, but they also had such a law in, you know, Dang's region of Gujarat and Rajasthan as well. Now that was met by a huge resistance. And witch killings did not stop. They were not suppressed. They went underground. And even the local chiefs, you know, who had become collaborators of the British regime, would hide cases related to witch hunting. Because it was outlawed and they were collaborators, they could not report it, of course, but they were hiding such cases, you know. And there's an article I published in 2007 in EPW where I talk about, you know, how witch hunting became a very conscious contour of resistance to colonial rule. And this is where, you know, this is related to this law that was passed in 1840s and 50s in three different regions. The idea that was gaining ground was that, you know, these Englishmen, they do not understand what kind of suffering we are having. We have witches who bother us all the time, and then when we try to kill them or, you know, bother them, these people would come to us. You know, they say if the magistrate would come to us and arrest us, put us behind bars. So they do not understand what is going on. They do not understand that the witches can kill you in many different ways. So there was a counter discourse building around the concept of colonialism, you know, that witches were flourishing under the benevolent rule of British Empire. that they don't allow us, neither they kill the witch themselves, and neither they allow us to kill the witches. And what they have done further is that all the chieftains that we have, they have made them collaborators, they have subdued them. So who do we go to? So when the law and order was loosened, as it happened during the Santhal rebellion, which is 1855-56, or the famous 1857 uprising, there were mass witch killings in the region. And this was seen as a resistance to colonial rule. So very different dimension, which I published earlier, you know, basically. And when you examine the judicial trials after the area came under control of the British, you know, most of them said that, look, we were suffering. And when we saw that there's an opportunity, because there's no law and order situation there, we killed all the witches along with their families. Right? In the second half of 19th century, there are two or three things, you know. There are strains generated by the impact of colonialism. Many of these things have been very widely understood, so I'll not go into details of that. But I'll just talk about three or four things, you know. The new social disorders, the distancing from forest, new kinds of diseases coming up, and famines, you know. And when I say the forest, you know, distancing from forest, I mean two or three things. This is also the time, 1850s, you know, is also the time when the railways are being built, you know. And since you talked about Purulia, the Ranchi Purulia Royal Line was being built upon there as well. So a lot of forest was destroyed to take care of that, you know. Also, you had forest policies, 1894, and then later in 1927, which regulated Adivasis' access to the forest. And then, you know, so their distancing, and they had been dependent, and also the traditional remedies had been dependent upon the herbs they could get. So the distancing of forests was one. The new diseases that were, so besides the local, you know, all the common diseases that they had, which they would blame on the spirits, or, you know, take account of, or they would remedy through the herbs and all. Now the new diseases that they have, and primarily there are two different kinds of concepts that are coming into being. One, things like the venereal diseases, or, you know, tuberculosis, or leprosy was being, you know, blamed on the outsiders which are coming into this. So with the British came the contractors, the financiers, the money lenders, the dikus, the outsiders, which the Adivasis would call dikus, you know. And there was a second set of things which are mainly epidemics, where you talk about smallpox, you talk about cholera. So they were being seen, the epidemics were being seen as the handicraft or handiwork of the witches. They were being seen that, you know, they are emerging out of seeds that the witches are, you know, putting in front of the doors of different people. And this is also at a time when the lots of famines are happening. 1866 is the general famine. But towards the end of century, 1896, 97, 1899, 1900, 1901, 1907, lots of famines are happening in the region. And this is happening in the context of a lot of pressure being put on the tribal economy through a variety and reduced access to the common property resources. And this was being ascribed to the work of male violent forces, which being one of them. From there, I move on to a slightly later period, which is, you know, late 19th, early 20th century. And there are three things at work here. I'm just trying to, you know, simplify them and categorize them under three heads, you know, three broad heads. One is lot of documentation happening. This is a time when, you know, the British rule has been established into the region, or they are trying to, you know, have more control over the region, extend juridical and political control over the region. So you have officials, you have Christian missionaries, you have ethnographers, you have anthropologists who are working in that region. And they are trying to document the tribe, to know more about them, to be able to rule them better. But within that, there are several sub-strands of huge politics which suited the different socio-political interests as well, and the locations and academic locations as well. And the third part is the second part. So the first was documentation towards the late 19th, early 20th century. The second part is the survey and settlement operations that were being carried out. So they're, you know, taking a record of all the land holdings, you know. So survey, settlement, you know, operations are being carried out in all the districts. And the third thing this is happening is a lot of, you know, rebellions are taking place. So, you know, some of you may have heard about the famous Bursa Munda uprising or the Tana Bhagat movement. They combine in different forms, you know, elements of resistance, revivalism, and reform as well. So these three things are happening. I'll talk about each of them. You know, first let me talk about the documentation. Now, all these are the different parties that have been involved: the Christian missionaries, the colonial state, the officials, the ethnographers, the anthropologists. And they were doing it with different kinds of ideas and socio-political locations and academic locations as well. Right? What they end up doing is they end up creating a body of knowledge. And you know, I must alert you that, you know, whenever you create a body of knowledge, it's not very innocent. It's very political as well. You need to look at this body of knowledge. Now, what is happening under this body of knowledge? What they did was they are trying to create, you know, scattered evidences related to witchcraft and putting them at one place. So compilations in different forms are happening, whether in the official reports or whether in the tracts produced by that, and through whatever elementary, print culture, they are being distributed. The second part, what is happening in this process was, you know, there's some kind of a centralization, a kind of a centralized system of belief which is being generated. All the scattered evidence is being brought together at one place. So crystallizing them, you know, what emerges is a very institutionalized set of beliefs. They end up inventing what was witch. So there was a new witch, you know, that has emerged, you know, basically. And that is not sufficient. There is a second part to it. The second part of it is the transmission of this knowledge. This knowledge was reproduced in all the gazetteers that you would read, you know, for that period. All the official accounts, the gazetteers of this knowledge. So that is serving now as a standard reference. If you want to define a witch, this is what witchcraft means, you know. All these elements mean witchcraft. So that was how this thing. Now, what happens in this, the process of doing that? In the process of doing that, many of those ideas which were associated with Western culture get, you know, diffused with the ethno-regional ideas of witch. What emerges is a new witch. What emerges is a new notion of witchcraft. So who is the new witch? The new witch is a person who is trained. She trains herself by participating in rituals in secret, as opposed to witch doctor who trains himself in the open. So it was no longer hereditary. It was an acquired art. You could acquire that art by training in secret. What also comes along with that is the idea of collectivity. The idea of witch gatherings, that they go to Sabbaths, they collect at Sabbaths on certain auspicious days, they dance, they, you know, learn witchcraft rituals, they get married to the spirits, they get married to the Satan. And then they learn the art of that, and they appoint successors as well. So this was very different, you know, from that idea of the witch that you were having this thing, you know, basically. The second part of it is that this witch is more powerful than the witch we would see earlier. So apart from that, you know, that apart from the things that you could see earlier, that evil eye and evil mouth, they could, you know, harm you to so many different ways, you know. A, directly through, you know, through the help of spirits, which they would control, or they would succumb to, or through some material medium. So evil eye, evil mouth, you know, eating your liver from a distance, you know, cooking your liver and with rice, you know, planting diseases, taking a form of a cat or a dwarf and then harming you, or harming your food grains. You know, something that we use, you know, the bindis, you know, that you put it in somebody's garment and then charge, that bindi would be charged, and so you suffer to that. And then through indirect means as well, like contagious magic, like overshadowing you. So this is a witch which is a more powerful witch. This is a witch which is a trained witch. And the other part which becomes very, very clear in all these accounts, and see how they are painting the tribe as well, that this is a very live and happening thing. You know, all these accounts that you read, you know, they say that it's such a big commonplace. You can encounter them everywhere. Everywhere they are happening, you know. So there are lots of witch stories which are coming into circulation as well. Now, when this is happening, the ways of dealing with the witch is also changing. So earlier you had, you know, you would have ordeals, you know, like, you know, throwing a witch in water. And when I say witch, I mean it in the single inverts, you know, throwing a witch in water. If she swims, then she is a witch. If she drowns, then she was not a witch. But in any case, she's dead, you know. Or oracles, you have different kinds of oracles, like the withering branch oracle. So, you know, what you would do is plant, you know, take, you know, branches of sal leaves, of sal tree, and then plant them in the morning in water. Whichever withers first, so one has to wither first, you know. That would be the witch, and I put names of all the, you know, accused there, you know. So, but they are now giving way to new kinds of things. Remember, this is this late 19th century, early 20th century is also a period where a lot of migrations are taking place because of the mineral possibilities. So lots of, you know, caste Hindus are migrating into the regions, you know. And this process had been going on for some time as well, because earlier the zamindars would have Hindu priests, they would have Hindu temples, and there were Hindu festivals as well. So what is now emerging are very complex exorcism rituals, which are underlined by sacrifices, which are underlined by mantras, incantations, or magical formulas known as jharnis, which were often composed in Hindi or Uriya or Bengali, not in that, you know, the language they would speak, not in Bandari, the language they would speak. And also systematic inclusion. So all those mantras and jharnis that you had related wherever you have these exorcism rituals would initially be, they were not so common, but initially they would, you know, adjure, or, you know, we were having this discussion in the morning, would be addressed to the tribal deities. They are now giving way to gods and goddesses. So the Durga or Vishnu or Shiva or Kalima, these are the ones they are being addressed to now. So there is a gradual Hinduization of the tribe that is going on as well. So that reflected the way in which, you know, caste Hindus were moving into the region. But there was another, this is also the time when market relations are penetrating, you know, and money relations are penetrating into the Adivasi societies, and which manifests itself in another thing, which is monetization of the witch trials. So the witch now would be fined and asked to behave. And if you don't behave, which means if the incident occurs again, you'd be fined several other times, you know. So repeated fines, that is working to the advantage of the people who would be sharing the spoils of these fines, you know. And also community fees. So, you know, this fine would be used for community fees. So one time where all the hungry people would get together to eat some, you know, what they would call good food, you know. So this whole dynamic is, you know, completely changing. And you know, there's a second part too. So this was the first part, which I talked about, was the part of documentation and the creation of a body of knowledge. The second part was, as I said, survey and settlement operations. Now, people, you know, I also think when I began research on that, but with the coming of permanent settlement in 1793, all, you know, land was getting, you know, the notion of private property had been established. But because of the fragile nature of this territory, you know, private property came to be established much later, towards the late 19th, early 20th century, when the survey and settlement operations were launched. What would the survey and settlements operations do? They would document the nature and titling of the land, right? And in doing that, they reinforced the customary tribal principle whereby only males could be formal and legal owners of land. So it's patrilineal and, you know, patriarchal and patrilineal. So land could only be passed through the male lineage. So women cannot own land. They could have certain rights to use the land. What that introduced? That introduced a very dangerous principle. All women who would now be in possession of land, and some of them were, as single women and as unmarried daughters, they had two kinds of rights. Right to manage the land and a produce of land, not own the land. And the second was right to get a share of the produce of the land. They were now getting targeted as witches. And under the customary systems of land inheritance, the land would pass on the next male agnate in the family. If there is a son, if not a cousin, or whoever is the next male relative. Right, so what that introduced was a very dangerous principle and the new political economy of witchcraft. We talk about land grabbing now, but that was introduced earlier. It did not become so common. It became more common in the post-colonial phase. But that introduced a very dangerous trend towards the destruction of the residual rights of women in land. And the third part, which I talked about, is the Adivasi movements. And I talk about two. There were many. I'm talking about two. Birsa Munda, which was the famous. So he begins with, you know, an ordinary person and, you know, almost assumes the form of a god, you know. So he's Bhagwan Birsa is what he's known as, you know. He begins his career as a witch doctor and uses this, you know, so this tribal movements, you are using this symbolism, imagery associated with witchcraft to further the interest as well, the leadership, you know. So Asur Kahani, or the Asur Kahani that I told you beginning, he would use this Asur Kahani in a tirade against the Asurs, you know. And in his fight against the British later, he uses this you know, song which says that, you know, kill the witches, the Europeans, and the spirits, you know. So all of them put together in one category of enemies, you know. And when you talk about Tana Bhagat movement, which is around 1915 to 1922, 2023, and a phase which was there later as well, there were active conversions. So people who would not, you know, convert to Tana faith, the women in the household would be declared as witches, and they would have limited access to public wells. Therefore, their livestock would be killed. There were many cases of killings from Ranchi district around this time. So these three kinds of things are, you know, giving a new shape to what is, you know, seeing as the idea of the witch, and also furthering the idea of the witch. Now, 1930s to 70s is a very interesting period, and I argue that this is a period about slow down in witch killings, but not dilution in the idea of the witch. The idea of the witch continued to be there, but there is dilution in the number of witch killings, and I argue that it was because of several things. That there was laws in place, but law in place was earlier as well. You know, Christian schools and missionaries and hospitals that are being set up, you know, raising awareness campaigns. But two very important things that are happening. One is because of these elements, you know, the revivalist elements in the tribal movement, they're borrowing a lot from Hindu, you know, ideas, you know. And one of the things that was emerging is that practicing witchcraft or this thing was seen as very degrading when you compare it with your caste Hindu neighbors. And there was one other thing, which is, this is also the 1930s and 40s, is also the time when Jharkhand movement is taking shape. Ethno-regional movements for a separate state was taking shape. So first was this Adivasi Mahasabha, which is 1938, and the Jharkhand party, which is 1950. They were mostly Christianized Adivasis who were, you know, supporting this movement. And the idea was that they are trying to build up a pan-Adivasi collective so they keep the internal tensions toned down, witch hunting being one of them. But in this phase, you know, while there is dilution, the slowdown in the number of killings, and I know when I was looking at, you know, they are not so, you know, comparable, like-to-like comparable figures. But whatever quantitative analysis that you have, you see a very clear case of perceptible decline. And the qualitative village studies also talk about that, yes, there are people who believe in that, but, you know, they are not killings which are happening. But even during this period, the idea of which was changing, right? One very interesting dynamic was, in the cases of Hinduized Adivasis, the witch was, the figure of the witch was being positioned outside the social and ethnic boundaries of the tribe. So if I were a Chiro, I would say that, look, we are bothered by the witches, but our women are not witches. There are other women who are witches, right? In the process, they are reinforcing gender and caste categories as well in the village. And then there are these ideas about which come up through the village studies is that, you know, it is becoming a centralized phenomena. So there are certain villages where, you know, you would learn this craft. It happens from, you know, October to June, July. In between that, you go, there are certain places, there are rituals, and they talk about that. And in places, in other times, you know, you go from Jamshedpur, you said, you know, there's this idea about Kala Jadu, which is coming into being, which is a magical technique which is passed on from one generation to another. Right? So during this period, and from there, this period of slowdown, I talk about a period of 1780s, where there's a period of revival, there's a period of resurgence, and there is a period of intensification in witch killings. Why is that happening? That's what happened during 1950s, 60s, 70s in Jharkhand, you know. This was a region which is very, very rich in mineral wealth. It was known as the Ruhr of India because of its the mineral wealth. So there are lots of, you know, the post-independence period, lots of, you know, this region is becoming, and many of the central Indian regions, is taking the brunt of development process, you know. So a lot of minerals are being, you know, taken away, lots of, you know, projects are being, you know, executed there as well. So industries, coal mines, big one, lot of, you know, coal, you know, across the country would be taken from there. Coal mines, multi-purpose projects, schools, hospitals, they were being done, you know. This is also the time because a lot of development is taking place, so people from other neighboring states are also migrating into the regions in search of livelihoods and jobs. What they end up doing is they end up displacing the Adivasis, first from the semi-skilled jobs, managerial jobs they could never get, and second from the unskilled jobs as well. So what is happening is twofold thing. One is dispossession, because there's a lot of projects happening, so the land is being taken away. And two is denial of the benefits of development. You're not getting a share of that. Obviously, a lot of other things happened. For example, reservation. Reservation in the legislative bodies, reservation in public sector undertakings. But only a small part of people could get into accommodated into that. For bulk of them, it still remained a period of strain, you know. How are they trying to come up with? It is in this phase of uncertainties, in this phase of strain, that something emerges about which this history, the region had a history. So the witch hunts start resurfacing. And they are now addressing all kinds of uncertainties that the Adivasi societies are facing. But now the figure of the witch evokes fear partly, but a lot of vulnerability is associated with this figure of witches. There are multiple ideas of witchcraft from the past that are being invoked. The whole idea of witch and witch hunting is getting very, very decentralized. What you see in 1980s is a lot of killings happening as a result of land grabbing. Because land is a very tangible resource, you know. So a lot of, you know, the hunt are happening, you know, people, women are being killed on account of being killed as witches, you know. As I said earlier, single women, either as unmarried daughters or as widows, would be entitled to a share of the land, not own the land, but they would be entitled to manage the produce and a share of the produce. This is being taken away. So all those women who are in possession of land are being, lots of things happening, lots of court cases happening in 1980s and things like that. From there, it's extending to all kinds of resources. So family disputes or village level property disputes would often, you know, come down to witch killings, and to, you know, branding of somebody as witch and driving away their family, even raping their daughters. And from there, you know, things that, so the range is coming, becoming wider and wider as the process of globalization sets into the region, you know, more and more things and more development sets into the region. 90s, you saw all those things happening. Even those women whose husbands are staying abroad and who are sending regular income to their wives, you know, because of the resources, are now being taken, you know, labeled as witch, and they are driven out of the village. But last, you know, 2000, the last two decades have, you know, come up with some very, very disturbing trends. One was feeding of excreta, human excreta. Right? Now, there are two things. One is you feed human excreta, or you feed sacrificial blood of a rooster which has just been sacrificed. And these two serve two different purposes. When you feed human excreta, the whole idea is defiling the body so the spirit would leave the body. So polluting the body. And when you put, you know, sacrificial blood, you are purifying the body so the spirit would leave away. Right? So this whole idea of, you know, feeding of human excreta was also coming into being. But in the last couple of decades, what has really been very, very tormenting, and not to speak of other things as well, is the idea of public humiliation. Parading women naked, attacking sexual rapes, sexual advances, public humiliation of all kinds, shaming them in public. This has now become, you know, this thing. And most of these events take the form of a spectacle. So these public trials that happen indicate that the new collectivities of violence are being formed in this region. And when I'm talking about all these things in this last couple of decades, whether it is land grabbing or women being, you know, subject to all kinds of sexual violence or feeding human excreta or, you know, rapes, you know, this is entirely true of the entire central Indian state. All these forms that I'm talking about, you know, that it is true of the entire, this is something which is happening across the central Indian belt. So it is not something which is limited to that. What happens there in the spectacle, you know, it is indicative of forming of new collectivities of violence. Now, this is a very strange collectivity. This collectivity diffuses, momentarily diffuses all the social and ethnic tensions in the village as other castes and other communities also participate in it, thereby giving it an extended public character, making it a village affair. So the whole idea that the witch was internal to a tribe or internal to a community, from that it has traveled to it's becoming a, you know, village affair. And that is now not limited to the Adivasis. You know, as I said, in the last few decades, you know, it had never been limited to Adivasis. In the last few decades, you know, Dalits, Muslims, socially and educationally backward caste, the OBCs, they've all been subjected to that. And it is there in the rural areas, but also in some of the Jaipur, for instance. And if you thought that many of the industrialized states would escape this, then let me tell you that 2010, Haryana was leading in terms of witch killing. Thank you. I'll leave on that note.
Thank you, Dr. Sinha. I think I just have to give an introduction before we open the floor to discussion. It's an extremely complex topic, and I think as Dr. Sinha said, that often we move away from discussing this topic just because we think it is just part of superstition. But you can see the social, sociological, political, psychological, and you know, multiply interrelated forces which is causing this phenomenon, and I think we all need to engage with it. So the floor is open for discussion. I mean, Dr. Sinha could either take a seat here or as you are comfortable.
I'll take that.
Okay.
Thank you so much for this fascinating lecture, sir. So I have 2-3 doubts regarding this, because I was also doing the same, like I have done my master dissertation on black magic. So I was dealing with these kind of things in my master's. So when I was dealing, but my point of view is very different from what you have started with industrial revolution, like some kind of the time period, if you'll put that after industrial revolution, what the socio-political change happens in that. But when I was looking, because I belong to archaeology, like I history and more deeper in that time. So when I was dealing with the idea, then I found that when you read the ancient text or something like that, and even in the material culture also. So if you take the example of Assam Mayong, so I have done my dissertation on Mayong Assam. It's called the witchcraft capital of India. So I have done there. So there I found during my survey that there are so many deities, like 8th to 10th century, like in Ahom kingdom or in Pala kingdom also. So proper deities which are currently practiced in the witchcraft, the dolls, and along with dolls, human maxilla, everything in there, very like horrific figures and something like that. So I found that the idea of witchcraft creation is, I found this very long before the industrial revolution happened in the socio-political context, the first thing. And the second point is you like the women right and the land grabbing. So we found that in Eastern India, it's always, we have like in ancient literature, if you go back and see that the Mitachara and Daivag or Yagvalka Smriti, so all these talks about the Stridhan, then there was always seen that in Bengal, Orisha or Assam, there is always rivalry between the school of Daivag and the school of Mitachara for the human right, for the possessing of land, wealth or something like that. So one school told that the Daivag school claims that the human can possess this, and but whereas the Mitachara school says that no, women has no right, she cannot. So this rivalry is long before that, this industrial revolution. So what is your take on that?
I think, you know, what you said was, in no way I'm suggesting that, you know, this does not have antecedents, you know. I'm just talking about a particular period for which we have somewhat sources, you know. So I'm working about the sources in a particular period. But no way I'm suggesting that the antecedents were not there. They were there in different forms, in different parts, you know. So for instance, you know, let me give you two examples, you know. Ibn Battuta talks about something called kaftar, which means a hyena in Persian, you know. It talks about, you know, a word which is used to describe. Abul Fazl talks about, you know, the concept of jigar khor, the liver eater. And more recently, in a book which it talks about in Orissa, 17th, 18th century, the idea of jigar khara, the liver eaters, you know, in Orissa. So 17th, 18th century is there. So obviously this, and earlier also, even British, before the British arrival on the scene, you know, there are lots of other things, you know. So you hear about Santhal ordeals, you know, where, you know, they would have different kinds of things. So one is the thing I talked about, withering branch oracle, you know. So they will collect branches from sal tree and, you know, put them in water and putting all the names of all the village women there, you know, whichever withers first is becomes accused, you know. Then you had this, you know, some rice was put in, you know, clothes of in clothes, wrapped in clothes and put there, and ants would be let loose, you know. So whichever gets depleted first, you know, becomes that. So lot of things are there, you know, But what I was trying to show here was that even in this 175 years that I study, how this whole idea first comes together, and there is a lot of change there as well. I'm talking about a period where I'm confident about the sources, you know. So you can see that, you know, there is a lot of change, but it also introduced, why colonialism is important, it also introduced lots of structural changes, which we redefine the idea of the witch as well. So whether, you know, making land a private property, and the second part, but lots of other things, forest legislations, you know, documentation, all those kinds of, or outlawing witch hunting. When I talk about Stridhana, I know that there's been a struggle between these two schools of thought. What I'm trying to locate them is in the context that how they became drivers of witch killing or witch hunting is not when the ownership comes into play by the permanent settlement, but when the titles are being recorded, they are being recorded in the name of men. So whoever is in possession of land around that time, they become very easy targets. So how this whole practice of land grabbing, which becomes more popular in the post-independence period, is a very popular extra-legal method of killing women. So how this becomes a driver of a practice which is not so desirable. So that's my take. Yes, please.
I had a small point. You mentioned that when the late 19th century, early 20th century, when the migration because of mineral wealth and other things started, the Hinduization happened. That is Durga, this side, the other. Certainly in Bengal, which I know of, the oppressed woman had always recourse to somebody like Monosha, etc. Did the same thing happen in these parts?
It's, you know, the sources that I see is you don't have women being represented in the writings, because it's not, this is a place where they are being represented through others. You know. In the case of witchcraft, most often these things, therefore I use the word constructions, it comes to the light when the woman has been murdered. But in the ethnographies or in the treatises that are produced by, you know, the anthropologists, you know, lot of these things come into play. So many of those things, you know, witchcraft, and I was very, very amazed when I started, you know, looking at the folklore related to the region. And they, it has several strands, you know, one of which is all myths in a way or other, you know, point to women, you know, as, you know, either the practitioners of the witchcraft, you know. The second one was, and where your question becomes important, is that all those things which were tabooed for women, right? So for instance, you cannot go to a burial ground or cremation ground. You cannot thatch a roof. You cannot, you know, plow. You cannot weave a, you cannot thatch a roof or many of those things. You cannot, you know, wield weapons. You cannot wear male clothes. You cannot worship the bongas because of two things. among the Santhals, it was believed that they are sexually promiscuous, so they are able to, you know, subdue the Bongas and make them work. Among the Mundas and Uraus, it was said that the women are weak, morally weak, so the spirits would overpower them. So all different constructs of that. But coming back to your question, you know, so it is not Manasa, but in the capacity of witchcraft, or, you know, all the folklore is indicative of one thing, that when they are in the sabbaths or the inner grounds, they could invert all those things that were other considered taboo. So you could wear clothes, you could wield weapons, you could dance with the bongas, you could get married to the spirits, and through them control others. The other part, which I thought was very fascinating, is that, you know, the officials, because they were so familiar with the idea, the colonial officials, the administrative officials, to the idea of witch, so they would constantly be questioning that, okay, tell me, where did you go? Which gathering did you go? And they were also documenting witch songs. I had access to two of them, you know, basically. And very interesting, both of them, and not only songs, but all the other stories which are current in the late 19th, early 20th century, talk about a very interesting alliance, which is between the mother-in-laws and the daughter-in-laws against the son or against the husband. Most of them are talk about that, you know. And it is replete with instances where they are killing the sons or the things, you know, that. So obviously it's a very patriarchal society, and they are, you know, restricted to lots of things as well. But that is indicative of, you know, lots of things. But to be very specific answers, many of those things. So they could, you know, Manusha would not be there as so popular, but they would have access to all the other spirits, you know, in their capacity as a witch. That's what the folklore is for.
Well, Dr. Sinha, I should really compliment you on this, you know, very, you know, it just leaves one really shaken. And this is a topic that has been, you know, discussed so little, and it's really wonderful work. And also compliment Professor Sangeeta Menon for the initiative of, you know, bringing this topics of this nature to light. And you know, I think it's a very important aspect of you know, these dialogues on what constitutes, you know, the consciousness and mind and the way we perceive and so on. And I was just wondering, because there seemed to be, now what you were saying about the Asurs, for example, where the you mentioned, of course, that the hereditary nature of the witches, maybe, or, you know, going back to those communities. And you also said that the widows were also then, I mean, were they also, let's say, seen in that light as, you know, witches once they were widowed and things like that. And so on. And then the way this has moved is, so you're saying that, you know, communities like Haryana, which did not maybe traditionally practice witchcraft, actually see this maybe because there is a lot of, you know, patriarchy and gender related oppression in a state like that also. So they find something that drives them in that direction over there. And I was also wondering, because I suppose, you know, to lay people like us, somehow witches is something we still might, you know, relate with somewhere like Africa, for instance, and we've heard of witch doctors and things like that. So what has the trajectory been, let's say, in comparison in a place like Africa, which also had, let's say, you know, the mediation by the British and so on, or is others, you know, I'm just wondering, you know, is there any kind of, other, those are completely unrelated aspects, or what would you say? Thank you.
Thank you. About the Asur, you know, this is, when I was talking about the Asurs, you know, I was talking about Asurs in two contexts, which is, you know, when I was talking about, you know, different kinds of ethno-regional ideas related to witchcraft, you know. So there are not too many of them. Asur Kahani was one of them. The Asurs are the iron smelters, you know, tribes which have often been seen as castes as well, you know. So they were the traditional iron smelters. So it you know, it's so, the story goes like this, that, you know, because of their misconduct, you know, they are thrown out of the heaven. And when they're thrown out of the heaven by the chief, you know, of the deities, which is Singh Bonga, so they land at a place. And what they do, they erect 7 furnaces over there, which they keep, you know, building higher and higher. And the flames would go so high that they started burning everything in and around the forest and other things, and till the time that this, you know, the flames reach heaven. at which point people pray that, you know, how do you save us from the asuras? So, you know, Singh Bunga descends, the chief, you know, spirit descends, you know, and by a trick gets them burnt in their own furnace, you know. So the widows come and say that, what do we do? You have burnt our husbands in this furnace. What do we do? So he said that, you know, look, they have been burnt because they were creating mischief, you know. And what we do is that, you know, you would be, you know, surviving on the offerings that you have, you know. So, you know, the idea goes that, you know, so they, some of them occupied the mountains, some of them occupied the rivers, some of them occupied the smaller channels, some of them occupied the fringes of the villages, and, you know, accordingly became spirits, you know, there, you know, right? Coming to the other point about Harya, sorry. No, the widows don't have that widow. So it is mostly, you know, as you know, supernatural beings that you derive subsistence, you know, now, and mainly of the offerings, because the spirits are continuous. The whole idea of the spirit world is a very organic one. What is very interesting is that, you know, you continue to invent new spirits. So, you know, during the colonial times, you would have a aeroplane bonga, you would have a chaprasi bonga. Chaprasi was seen as a very powerful who would move the file from here to that place, you know, right? You would have a train bonga because the railway is coming to that, you know. But more important, even it was a very personalized. So if somebody, you know, said that I saw somebody in dream taking away some of our animals, that would be conceptualized. So they would, the whole world of spirits would continue to grow. But largely speaking, they were bodily of two kinds. One is a kind of a more, you know, beneficent ones, and one of the male efficient ones. And the whole idea was to try and appease the, you know, either appease the ones who are, you know, very angry with you or male efficient, or what you try and do is you try and win over the beneficent ones, and through them either control them. But one of the things which is very striking in the case of that is even the beneficent thems are not able to control the male efficient ones. But coming to your point about, you know, from where the spirit, you know, to Haryana, there are two, three things I want to say here. As I said that, you know, parts of, you know, what I said, I could see elements in the historical past of several regions, but not Haryana. That may be because that has not been adequately researched, maybe that it has did not have a case of witch killing as well. But what I could see is in the last couple of decades, this whole phenomenon has become common in the entire Central Indian belt. And National Crime Records Bureau, you know, regularly, you know, puts, you know, this thing about 10 to 12 states, killings of that. And when I said, you know, 2,500 women killed between 2001 to 2017, it's just about killings, which they document under the heading of murder according to witchcraft. What it doesn't document, and what, you know, the phenomenon does not become so clear to us and so pervasive, the pervasiveness of the problem does not become, is the entire range of witch hunting that happens. So whether it is physical violence, killing, beating, attacks on property, fines, name calling, ostracism, social boycott, banishment, to public shaming, feeding human excreta, you know, blackening faces, you know, branding sexual organs, to stigma loss, those kinds of things. So the entire gamut, that does not come under what is this thing. So National Crime Records Bureau is only able to show a part of the problem. But the fact that even in Haryana, if you could see in 2010, you know, it was leading in terms of number of witch killings, then that means, you know, it is more pervasive than what has normally been thought about. So my idea was to indicate that, you know, this is not something which is limited to particular regions or particular tribes or particular castes. It's becoming very common, but unfortunately does not get noticed. 6 states in India have specific anti-witch, you know, legislations to deal with this. 2 states have broader legislations. You know, Karnataka and Maharashtra have broader legislations regarding black magic and superstition. But 6 states have specific, you know, laws relating to witch hunting, very specific, in addition to the Indian Penal Code and sometimes criminal code as well.
Thanks, sir, for this fascinating lecture. Actually, I have 2 questions. So, first is regarding to this, as you narrated about this formation of this post-colonial subjectivity with the introduction of this body of the knowledge and this permanent settlement, that how the newly post-colonial subjectivities has been formed, and how this self-image has been formed, and it has made the new image of the witch as the constitutive outside, which will affirm the notion of newly formed subjectivity. So, so the question is that as you also mentioned through the witchcraft and through this public spectacle, it seems that the violence has become a kind of performativity, which is affirming this newly formed post-colonial and newly formed collectivities. So one question is this. Second is as your presentation was that it is more like the genealogical account of how this discourse of historical discourse of the witch has been formed. So my question is that can we also think of this more some phenomenological account of witch, because might be the notion of witch in itself might be pointing towards the more kind of the intertwining between the self and the world, which after the coming of the scientific objectivity or with the colonial subjectivity, the world is divided into there is divide between the nature and culture. So might be the idea of witch in itself pointing towards that intermingling of that realm, where there is the more intermingling between the nature and the culture, humans.
I think, you know, when I talked about body of knowledge and the related subjectivity, I was talking to a particular point in history, late 19th, early 20th century. So I don't connect it then with the idea of public shaming, you know, right? This happens, in, as I said, in the last couple of decades. What I wanted to stress there, you know, in terms of that subjectivity was that, you know, many of those ideas which were not common here. And there is a second thing that I wanted to hint at is that body of knowledge has its own set of politics, you know. How do you choose to document people, right? Now, let me give you some instances, you know, and at one point of time, you know, I had argued that, you know, late 19th, early 20th century, it suited all the agents and forces to have a witch. Everybody wanted to have a witch. Every party wanted to have a witch. And I'll tell you examples. Colonial state used it as a way of obtaining police powers. So whichever villages would report killings of witches, they would take away police powers from the zamindars. And they were extending the political control. That, look, you cannot handle that. Right? So the state of Kolhan that was formed, one of those things was, you know, that, you know, A, there are frequent uprisings. Two, there are, you know, dark runners who would carry the dark. There's, you know, are constantly being, you know, this thing. But also because people, you know, this people, lot of women die or lot of people die on account of witch killings. So the colonial state is continuously using this idea to extend juridical and political control. You know, second half of 19th century is also the time that ethnography is using, you know, or becoming common as the most scientific framework for studying the linguistic and cultural identities of people who were dark-skinned, who were non-Europeans, and belong perhaps to the pale of outside the pale of civilization. This is also the time when the ideas of social Darwinism are becoming very, very current. What emerges in those ideas was that many of those officials were actually motivated and influenced by those ideas. That there are higher cultures, there are lower cultures. There are people who are much down the evolutionary scale or perhaps outside of the pale of civilization. How do you identify them? Witchcraft or witch hunting and primitivism is one of those things. So the whole, and so the first generation of anthropologists who started documenting them were very influenced by these ideas as well. So they would talk in terms of higher cultures and longer and lower cultures. So the whole politics of primitivizing the tribe when hand in hand with documenting them as followers of witchcraft, followers of animist witchcraft and things like that. And that is one of the things which was also bothering the census officials. They did not know how to classify them. So in one way they would see the followers of other religion, in one census they would come across as, you know, tribes, in one census they would come across as animists. So, and then, you know, talk about, and it also suited the Christian missionaries, because one of the things, that the first line of thing that they were having is, they were providing legal assistance to Adivasis for court cases that were pending, you know. because the Adivasis did not have any, aid in that form. That so one of the ways in which missionaries were gaining, converts in the area was to providing them legal support. But they gradually realized that lots of other things also need to be addressed too, witchcraft being one of them. And the way it was addressed, that is that Jesus has Christians, and I'm just saying it has Christians under the special care. So when you become a Christian, you don't have this fear of witchcraft. So one fine day you completely done away with the witchcraft thing. You don't have any fear. It obviously did not work that way. But the lure of conversion was always there. Right? Likewise, when I talk about this thing, when the new idea of witch comes into play, there is a whole this distinction which is coming into play as well, another distinction, which is a socially male-ficient black magic versus socially benevolent white magic. The white magic practitioners are, the Jan Gurus or Sokhas or, Ojhas, and the practitioners of black magic being the witches, right? So I was talking to you in a very specific point of time, and that is not what I'm relating to, public shaming. Public shaming comes, I would say in terms of time frame, more than 80 to 100 years after that. It comes in more recently, right? Your second...
On this, because my question was that, because in the world, where this body of knowledge is produced, then there is also, as you mentioned, the internalization of this new image of witchcraft.
Yes.
Which resulted in the killing of the
Woman who doesn't have who are single woman and who owns land. So I was just my question is that how this internalization of this discourse which has been produced by the body of knowledge, this led to the formation of this new kind of the subjectivity.
I think it in a very simple way I could say it created new avenues of witch killing. Right? Land was one of them. But then, as I said, there are lots of other things which are also happening when you start internalizing those beliefs. So, while, earlier they would be straight away killed, as I said, that is hereditary and the idea is to remove that thing. There are other things which are happening, also happening during this period when this body of knowledge is being created, is that market relations and monetary relations are also permeating Advaita societies. One of the ways in which these two things are happening, two manifestations, distinct manifestations you could see is the complex exorcism rituals that are coming into place, which have sacrifices, which have new mantras, which have new jharnis, which are magical formulas, which are being sung because there's a lot of mobility from Orissa, from Bengal, and other places. So you have this, address in languages which are not tribal languages, but Hindi, Uriya, or Bengali, right? And the idea of fines, monetary fines, so rupees, terms of rupee, that comes into being, it's creating a new kind of thing. So, land just was one, instance of that. But land, it did create a new political economy of witch killings, but it became more common in post-colonial times. But these things became very important. The idea of fine became monetary fine. So there's a certain amount of rupee that you have to pay and ask to behave. And if the evidence happens again, you have repeated fines. So in a first instance, you'll be fined 10 rupees. Next instance, you'll find 25 rupees and few chickens. And there is a logic in which it's working because it works to the advantage of some of the people who are fining and the division of the proceeds as well. So the Ojha takes a share of it, the village headman takes a share of it, and the rest is divided, are organized to have community feasts, the people would work welcome. Your second question, I'm not too sure whether I'll be able to answer. The whole idea between the self and the world, or the nature and you said the nature and the human. Huh? I don't think, I will be able to answer that way, but where the element of nature comes in I'm just trying to address that bit of it. So, the element of nature comes in, women being equated as being more friendly and integrated with nature. Now, this partly had its origin in the division of labor, whereby they are allowed to collect, they gather forest produce, right? Collect fuel, fodder, and forest produce as well. Now, as a result of that, women had very good knowledge of, you know, the forests, the various kinds of trees and herbs as well, vegetables and things like that, right? Which could often, and very relevant, talks about, you know, how women shamans, where, you know, you would go to women shamans for, you know, treatment. So women were seen as, you know, custodians of herbs as well. They knew, and they had, not only that, they had very good direction capabilities, because they would venture in the forest all the time, collecting firewood, collecting fodder, collecting, you know, herbs as well. So their knowledge of herbs was very important thing. Now, the interesting bit was that, you know, when it came to acquisitions, you know, then it is the negative knowledge of herbs which was emphasized, which is that because you have access to herbs, so you know all those things which are poisons, right? So you are poisoning people, right? So Moria is a poison. They said that, you know, that, you know, women, when they become witch, you know, or when they take recourse to witchcraft, it is the negative aspect of their knowledge of the herbs or forest which was being emphasized upon. The whole idea was also to keep them away from a very organized healing profession as well. So you could be associated with smaller things. You know, there's instance of women also being involved with minor surgeries, like, you know, boils, you know, nose boils and things like that. They were involved with that, you know, also to help, you know, women patients, you know. But also in terms of massage and fomentations, there were, you know, lots of things, evidence to that as well. But when it came to organized healing, you know, in terms of women cannot become ojhas, you know. So when you are too, you know, because ojhas would also mean that your familiarity with the spirit world as well. So your familiarity with the spirit world cannot happen because it is a tabooed thing. So the only way in you which you could have access to the spirit world is by through the medium of witchcraft. So whenever women would be, you know, this knowledge about nature or the connection with nature would be emphasized, it was mainly through the dealings of witchcraft. I think that's the only thing that I can come.
Sir, is there any instance like Joan of Arc instance in some of these anecdotes you have told, recorded or in our myths, a parallel thing?
Please, you know, can you give
Joan of Arc.
But give me more details.
She was suspected of being a witch, though she was a spy and she was burnt at stakes. Such things have happened in our country or in other cultures. Is Western and this is our.
You mean to say that, you know, the idea of burning, you know,
burning, burning at stakes, that happened there.
I think, you know, there are quite a few instances of burning as well. It would vary from country to country. It would vary from parts of the different parts of the country. But yes, burning, you have instances of women being burnt as well as witches, you know. Proclaimed as witches, but are obviously, you know, not in the same capacity because she is an influential political figure as well. And now here, you know, people who would be seen as transgressing the social norms are not being conformist would be tried as witches and punished, you know. Burning could be one of them. But we have less instances of burning than about other things as well. There are, you know, instances of, you know, women being roasted, you know, slowly roasted. But burning, we have fewer instances as opposed to that. But not in terms of influential political figures, you know. But yes, you know, people who would go out of the social confines, you know, or would go outside of the sexual taboos, you know, or go outside of the relations of marriage, you know, or go outside of many things, you know, where you would be, or trying to speak on behalf of, or would, you know, speak on behalf of larger set of people, or even transgressing the taboos, you know, they would be tried as witches. But in burning was there, but not very common. So few cases.
Because you said colonial powers were using to withdraw the police rights or police forces from some regions. Whether they have been used in wars to get information, any recorded thing, witches, officially.
I think when I used colonial power, then I used this in the context where, you know, where I was saying that, you know, all the parties were having strategic interests as well, you know, when it came to the idiom of witchcraft, you know. What they did and what comes nearer to what you are saying, you know, I may not have a very definite answer to you, to your question, is that, you know, they did a lot of documentation for sure, you know, right? And in this documentation, as I said, you know, there is a certain image of witch that comes out, which also in the process of documentation, many of the Western ideas of witchcraft also become diffused in, and or also merge with, or also intersect with, you know, the ethno-regional ideas of witch, you know, to assume a different form, if that comes closer to your question, you know, basically.
Okay, thank you.
Perhaps on this rich data and information and analysis, are there first? And so perhaps now we will close the evening. So usually our format is that we also have a young scholar to deliver the vote of thanks for the lecture. So I request our scholar Rakesh Kumar, who himself has devoted earlier years, he's a young person, so, you know, the earlier years of his, so he has worked in Assam, and he has also worked on black magic traditions. He's from, he's an archaeologist, and his background is, his degrees are from Deccan College and Banaras Hindu University. So may I request Rakesh Kumar to give the official formal word of thanks.
Very good evening to all. I feel very privileged and honored to deliver the word of thanks in behalf of NIAS Consciousness Study Program and as well as the Institute. So I felt my heart, I give my heartfelt thanks, or I extend my heartfelt thanks to the scholar, so Dr. Shashank Sinha here, who has delivered the insightful lecture, very eye-opening lecture to the academic community, basically, which we basically think these kind of things are dogmatized, should be dogmatized or should not be discussed very openly in the public forum or something, which is in the framework of the academic community or something like that. But I really, really thank you, sir, for this insightful lecture, or being, for your divine presence here and giving us some ideas, or at least giving us this some moment to think and contemplate about the socio-economic condition of the witchcraft, which is the contextualization of witchcraft in the socio-economic condition and their political use, and as well as the religious urge of the socio, the use of witchcraft in the context of, in basically you talked about in culture of Indian history, historical framework starting in the, like, in context of tribal rights and tribal, the formation of the tribe, the witchcraft in the tribes. I thank you so much for this, for your insightful, and thank you. I thank Professor Sangeeta Mayan for chairing the session, and I thank all of you here who has made this lecture for this very successful, and are asking for so many questions and very insightful observations. So thank you so much once again. Thank you very much.